Friends, I'm Philippe Husser. I have one mission to help PMOs better succeed in complex worlds. And today, I'm going to discuss with you what black swans are in our lives, why PMOs should prepare their projects for black swans, and how they can do this. When I was young, I had the belief that life was linear. You just have to find a goal, develop a path, and find means to realize your goal. To tell the truth, when I look backwards and when I connect the dots, I have to admit that I was totally wrong. Life is not linear at all. Life is full of surprises. This is why I focus my work today and our discussion together on what PMOs can do about this. Imagine you are a PMO in an airline or in a work from home service provider. Just look at the figure on the right. You see a typical illustration of how life is full of surprises. The orange curve shows airlines business this year, the blue curve shows the work from home business. And as you see, the pandemic was a huge surprise for all, huge pain for some, big opportunity for others. If I look at my career, I've seen tens of portfolios and thousands of projects of all sorts. What strikes me, above all, is what the chart on the right shows. Horizontally are the projects ranked by growing positive impact. Vertically are the sizes of impact. Out of thousands of projects, most projects are in the middle, with a rather slightly negative or slightly positive impact. A few projects on the left produced a very negative impact. I'm thinking of a large ERP project which failed, or a new product introduction that never found customers. A few projects on the right delivered a huge impact, often much larger than anyone could have imagined. Most of the time, the projects on the left and on the right were due to some kind of high-impact, unpredictable event, either from inside or outside. If they were predictable, first, they would have never generated a huge loss. And second, everyone would be a winner. But what are black swans? This term has been recently made very popular, yet not always fully understood, by Nassim Taleb, a former option trader, now teaching risk-taking in an uncertain world. Before the discovery of Australia, people were convinced that all swans were white, for the simple reason that all the swans they had seen until then were white. However, in 1697, Dutch explorers discovered black swans in Western Australia, and you can imagine their surprise when they understood that all swans were not white. Taleb calls black swans events that have the following three attributes. First, they are outliers, as they are outside the realm of regular expectations. Second, they carry an extreme impact. Third, they are explained after a fact through a retrospective predictability. And it's important to note a fourth attribute, they are observer dependent. Let me take an easy illustration from Taleb. It's the story of a turkey. As you know, the North Americans have a tradition to eat a turkey at Thanksgiving. So imagine a turkey receiving day after day grain and water from a farmer. Every single day firms up the turkey's belief that it will receive food every day and that humans are very friendly. However, on the afternoon of a Wednesday before Thanksgiving, something unexpected happens to the turkey. The farmer cuts its throat and it's too late for the turkey to revise its belief. It's dead. The farmer and his knife created a black swan, a big surprise, for the ignorant turkey. The turkey conflated absence of evidence with evidence of absence. So, the purpose of my discussion today with you is that neither you nor your stakeholders become a turkey. Several times in my life, I've been a turkey. I can admit this. I was running, for example, in the 90s, a turnaround initiative in the defense industry. After several years of huge efforts from everyone, we produced fantastic results. Our customers ranked us among their preferred suppliers. The employees increased visibility, their engagement level, and their satisfaction, and financials dramatically increased. Yet, the program made the company so appealing that our two biggest shareholders joined together and sold us to our number one competitor. This acquisition, I have to say, created many redundancies, and most of the leadership team and a huge percentage of the workforce became redundant and had to leave, including myself. Let me profit of this example to share an important point. My boss was the CEO of the company. When he hired me, we signed a contract mentioning that my job would be suppressed in case of success. This is really a practice I recommend that you apply as a PMO. Prepare to lose your job if you fail. Prepare to get a new job if you succeed. Put your skin in the game. But unpredictable surprises can also be very favorable. Here's another example I'm happy to share with you. A few years ago, I was the PMO of a large worldwide program. This program had around 300 projects of all sorts. Project leaders and PMOs were all over the world. We had a very swift and frequent set of reviews to help each other succeed. Unfortunately, we still used Excel spreadsheets to communicate our progress together. So I used this program as an opportunity to replace these spreadsheets with a single SharePoint-based project portfolio management system supplied by a consulting firm I was working with. The user experience was so good, however, from bottom to top, that soon, by word of mouth, scores of other project leaders and sponsors asked to join the platform. And 1 year later, the PPM was supporting 4,000 users, 100 portfolios, and 7 projects in all parts of the world, all this at a very low cost. So you, PMO, can understand now that black swans can kill you, ruin you, or make you a big winner. And let us see now why and how. Why do we have surprises, large, unpredictable events? If you build a small house with Lego bricks, you don't get black swans. Except, of course, if your little son goes by and involuntarily kicks it. I believe that black swans are, in fact, the pure products of the complexity of the world. Complex comes from the Latin word complexus, which means intertwined. Complexity comes from a very large number of components you have in a system that all interact together in myriads of interactions impossible to control and understand. The graph you see on the right is a typical illustration of a complex system. It's a network of my 23,000 plus connections on LinkedIn. Nobody can understand with enough detail this complex environment. Only God can. So because you cannot grasp this complexity, you have surprises. One of the most important characteristics of complex systems is that they are highly unpredictable. During my entire life, I've been surprised by the number of times a prediction did not realize, including mine. Think of the great John Maynard Keynes, for example, who said 2 years before the 1929 crash that, I cite, "We shall not see any more crashes in our time." And 2 years later, of course, as you know, we had this huge crash. Think of Ben Bernanke, the US Federal Reserve Chairman, saying in 2004 that recessions have become less frequent and less severe. Then came the 2008 crisis. Business plans rarely realize also in the project management domain. Neither business cases that project sponsors produce to get the go-no-go decisions. Predicting black swans or the non-existence of black swans is very risky if you don't want to be considered as a fool. Also, complexity creates avalanche-like emergent behaviors. You first have to recognize that you are part of complex adaptive systems. Complex because of the infinite number of components, all interacting together in an impossible to describe ensemble. Systems because they are processes with inputs, outputs, and all sorts of feedback loops. And adaptive because they adapt to their environment. And adapting to their environment, they change this environment in a never finished evolutionary journey. So an interesting characteristic of these complex adaptive systems is that they generate emergent behaviors. This behavior of a system cannot be simply inferred from the behavior of its components. Take a caterpillar. Imagine the complexity of what's happening when it becomes a butterfly. This is similar to what happens in social organizations, I believe. When you introduce a change, even insignificant, you are never sure of the result, and worse, if this result is unfavorable, you cannot go back and start the experiment all over again. So, as a PMO, understand that the end result of any complex project may be the emergence of something you are far from controlling. Another characteristic of complexity I want to share with you is the trade-off between complexity and scale. Let us look at the figure on the right. It's an illustration taken from Yanner Barian, an expert in complex systems. If you produce and sell many different goods, yet only a few of each type, typical of a space industry or of some luxury goods industry, your complexity is high and the scale of your operation is low. Conversely, if you produce and sell a few different goods, yet many of each type, typical of the automotive industry, for example, your complexity is low and the scale of your operations is high. In a project, you will describe the individual behavior of project team members, of a project team behavior, of a behavior of a two full organization concerned by the project. So you understand, the level of complexity of a system, which means a project in its environment, depends on the scale to which you look at it, and as a PMO, you must address this. Complex systems also require some kind of order between full order and full non-order. Adaptability arises when there are many possible actions happening in parallel that are mostly independent from one another. Efficiency, on the other hand, arises when many parts of a system are all working in concert so that the system can perform the task for which it has been designed at the largest possible scale. Efficiency tends to fragilize the whole system by eliminating redundancies and contingencies. That's what we see today with our global supply chains, for example. That's also what we discovered in France when the COVID-19 arrived. One of my daughters is a nurse. She had to use garbage bags during the first weeks of the pandemic. The Boeing 737 MAX 8 also lacked the required redundancy in its system that made it vulnerable to a single point of failure and led to more than 400 deaths and billions of loss for Boeing and airlines. So your PMO have to address this trade-off between adaptability and efficiency and to be multi-dimensional in everything you do. But there is no trade-off with velocity. Let me explain. There is another effect in complex systems called the Red Queen effect you absolutely need to understand. It is inspired by Lewis Carroll, a book Behind the Looking Glass make Alice meet a Red Queen who tells her, "Now, here you see, it takes all the running you can to keep in the same place." It is about entropy, or simply said, energy and information flows. The maximum entropy production law tells us that complex adaptive systems maximize the way they dissipate their energy or their information. That's very important. Let us take an example of this phenomenon. Imagine you have a cabin in the mountain. You keep its warm air inside during the winter. But if you open the door, the heat will rush outside as fast as possible through the open door. Or suppose that people are talking outside the cabin. If you open a window, you can listen much better to what they say and even memorize it. The social organization does precisely the same if open to the outside. And it tends to do this, says this law, ever more and faster. This is at the origin of a multiplicative, non-linear, high and fast growth of organizations like Wikipedia, Amazon or Alibaba in China. By doing these, organizations dissipate their energy. This in turn modifies the environment, which pushes them to absorb even more information to adapt to the change they created themselves. So here also, whether you like it or not, the world is accelerating, and so are or should be the way you manage your projects. If you cannot predict an event, you can work and you should work on its consequences. So remember that I mentioned a key finding. Some projects are like avalanches in the tail with big losses or big gains. On the left, they create heavy pain. On the right, they create huge benefits. On the left side again, the unfortunate side, you have again this Boeing 737 MAX 8 with several hundreds of lives. On the right, you have a Sydney Opera House project with millions of visitors. My key point here is that if you cannot and should not work on the event, you cannot predict it, the black swan, unpredictable again, you must, however, and you can, prepare and work on its consequences. It's totally different from evaluating a probability. Don't work on probability, work on the consequences of an event. For this, you as a PMO have to make sure that one, you hedge against the negative impacts on the left, and two, you capitalize on the right side to get the largest possible gains. There are three domains PMOs should study and learn now. Let's look at the house. How can strategic thinking help you? Which kind of system governance you should implement? And what kind of human dynamics you should favor and develop around you? Let's start with the strategic thinking. You should hedge the potential harm and facilitate the potential benefits. How can you protect your left side and profit from the right side? Nassim Taleb, again, explains very clearly what you have to do. You need to be as hyper-conservative on the left and as hyper-aggressive as you can on the right. And don't care for what's in the middle. Get rid of it if you can, or let others take care of it. Taleb called this strategy a barbell strategy, you understand why. Something on the left, something on the right, nothing in the middle. Let's take a practical illustration. Imagine you manage a complex program whose goal is to make your organization more ready to catch growth opportunities. If you want to pull a heavy wagon, hire one of several strong horses. If you want to climb a tree and collect walnuts, hire a squirrel. Don't try to make horses climb the tree or squirrel pull the wagon. If you want your organization to catch opportunities of growth, you need both horses to develop efficiently your existing business to finance the growth, and you need the squirrels to collect the nuts, the growth opportunities. So what you can do is this. Create a portfolio of many projects or program components whose goal is to deliver resources you will use to develop your growth. This is the light blue part of the drawing. Make sure that these projects are low risk, even if each of them remains too small to make a major impact on your growth. Make absolutely sure that none of these projects can endanger the whole program. Then add to this portfolio projects that have a chance to create a major positive impact. This is the dark blue part of the drawing. Here you can be very aggressive. You can take risks. You only have to stop the initiative very rapidly if it doesn't demonstrate its potential for big gains. You will pursue it as long as it needed to get your promise and objective. Note that this program strategy is path dependent. Iron your shirt after you washed it, not vice versa. So the first thing you do is to avoid ruin on the left side in being hyper conservative in what you do. Put in place redundancies. Create options that you can activate if needed. Maintain contingencies and additional resources ready to act if needed. And above all, install a very swift governance able to very rapidly act if needed, including stopping the project or one of its components. When things go bad, most people try to delay tough decisions. The situation only gets worse. That's what most governments in the West have done, I think, so far with the COVID pandemic. Do the opposite. Take rapid decisions. Only then, take care of the right side of the equation. Here again, be aggressive, swift, agile, fast, shrewd. For example, don't launch these risky yet high impact initiatives altogether in parallel. Why not install a rhythm? Work in series. Start with one. Focus the executive attention on the second initiative. When and if this one is ready to take off, delegate its pursuit to a high potential or some leader somewhere. If not, stop it and start a second initiative, and so on. Here the goal is to let a favorable potential deploy as long as needed to get the maximum gains. Here also, most people prefer to sell rapidly a favorable position. Do the opposite, but without getting bogged down in too many heavy projects at the same time. You would dilute your energy and decision-making capability. When establishing your strategy, do not forget that strategic wisdom exists all over the world. For example, Western strategy is rather direct. You say, let's define a goal, identify means, and select ways to achieve a goal. This direct approach imposes the will of an architect or of a politician on the environment. And the question for you as a project manager is, can we use and operate as a technician when it comes to determining social behaviors? And the answer, or my answer, is no. The traditional Western approach is subject to the contingencies of complexity. The more a project deals with social environments, the less a direct approach is going to work. As a symbol of this approach, you see here the Babel Tower, and you all know how it ended up. The indirect strategy, conversely, says, let us understand the situation, detect a potential, and take profit of circumstances to benefit from this potential. Understood in this fashion, circumstances are no longer something unpredictable. Instead, they can progressively be turned to advantage, and you invest now for a future that is not yet determined. However, it requires humility and patience. As a symbol of this approach, of course, you see the corn on this figure here, this image. You weed, hoe, and water the corn, and then it is best to wait for the moment of ripening. But it's going to happen one day. Now let's see which kind of system governance you should implement to do this. Lesson number one I learned is that your governance system must be at least as complex as your environment. Look at the picture. On its left, you see a sample of outside behaviors that require that you do something, that you respond. On its right, you see an illustration of your responses. In some cases, your response fits with a solicitation. In one case, you have a response, yet not of the same color. It does not fit. In some cases, you have no response, or response but no solicitation. Are you managing your system correctly? No. To be effective, a system must be at least as complex as its environment behaviors to which it must differentially react. This is the HP's law, the law of requisite variety. If a system must be able to provide a different response to each of the five environmental possibilities, and if you have only four possible actions, the system will not be effective. It shows you, for example, the limitation of any control by a single man. Your system cannot be more complex than the complexity of a single individual. It shows you how teamwork is powerful. A typical illustration was, or is your governance system able to address a work from home or a lockdown request? A strategic change of your number one customer? A 10 times increase in authorized capex due to the unexpected success of your project? All kinds of solicitations, needs, which your governance system need to be able to answer. And this governance system must be multi-scale, as we have seen. Do you remember what I said about complexity and scale? There is an equilibrium to be explored between this complexity and the scale. As a consequence, you should build your governance system with a multi-scale version of a law of requisite variety. Even if it's a parallel governance system, only connected with your organization's governance system, you cannot change, for example. Create connections with the bottom and with the top, and adjust the rhythm, the format, the agenda of your management system, of your governance system, according to the scale and the complexity of what you want to govern. Do not apply the same to every scale. Apply, again, a multi-scale version of a law of requisite variety. Now let's see a few snapshots on what kind of human dynamics you should favor to develop and develop around you to favor both the strategy and the complexity things I've mentioned before. First, study and learn human dynamics. It is my strongest conviction today that people are first. They can be employees or customers, but people are first. And to me, leadership is way too restrictive. Studying and learning human dynamics is a must. Human dynamics comprise the actions and interactions of personal, interpersonal, societal factors, and their effects on behavioral outcomes. For example, one, the ability to understand people, their culture, the norms, beliefs, the customs they have, their motivations, and so on. Second, the application of psychology, sociology, anthropology, cognitive sciences, neuroscience, and all sorts of sciences. And third, they comprise the sciences, technologies, data management used to understand the human behaviors at different scales. And that's just a sample of what you should study and what comprises human dynamics. Illustration one, diversity is a key success factor in what we do. Yet complexity rises when diversity rises. Cultural traits exist and are different. What's common with someone in ISIT or in sales, in Germany and in China, young and old? Of course, we have a common culture, but we have also very specific differences. If you want a project to succeed, a global project, an important, a major, complex project, you have to understand each other's culture and develop a mutual understanding. And adjusting a posture and an approach to specific cultural traits is highly important. The graph here shows an example of such cultural traits in different countries. For example, you can read on the second line, egalitarian versus statutory, the difference between low status countries like the US, where everyone can speak with everyone, and higher status countries like China or India or Middle East. The age, for example, in China, everybody respects, not in the US, I think. If you set targets, make sure that you will give face to your Asian friends. And beware of the way you manage your action lists with your KPIs. If you review an action plan, be direct in the US or Germany, but give face to Asian friends again with a more indirect style. This requires learning over a long period of time. And at the individual level, for example, you can learn with many knowledge bases or by living abroad. At team level, of course, you may be helped by coaches helping you understand each other. And more generally, ask your HR team to develop policies, internal mobility, and learning and development solutions. The second thing to do, very important, I learned in my experience, is the use of decentralized communities of intransigent allies. Your first asset, of course, is your purpose as a PMO. For example, make the project succeed. Or better, make your shareholders shine. Be happy. But your second first asset is a community of allies. An ally is someone willing to support your cause, but also ready to challenge it. An ally does this because he or she finds benefits in this cause. Personal benefits and organizational benefits. Don't forget both. These people, these allies, should be ideally decentralized. They should be localized in key parts of the organization from bottom to top. They will represent your cause, where they are, and they will deploy it. They will bring to you key information about their environment and help you adjust your strategy. They need to be also quite intransigent. We know that it's enough to have a very few percent of very intransigent people spread over a vast population to make this population accept and follow the rules of this minority. So my tip is to start not with too many people, but with credible, influential, intransigent and taking charge people. If you do this, you will end up as a corporate PMO sooner or later, with PMO friends in most functions, business units, localizations, forcing to follow the variety of PM roles of a game, and sooner or later, the entire organization's maturity will visibly increase. And by the way, by doing this, you share the load. You don't have to ask Mr. CEO, can I have a 10 people team or a 20 people team and get a no answer, okay? You share the load with skin in the game friends, acting as PMOs all over the organization. And you become very active. And believe me, at the end, you will increase the project management maturity of the organization in a very innovative and powerful way. So it's time now to conclude. I also want to share with you first my absolute certitude that you PMOs have a bright future. The complexity of our world requires more than ever that professional actors help project managers and develop project management all over the organizations, private, governmental, and so on. And to play your role during the next 10 years, however, I urge you to study and learn, especially the three following points. And by the way, thank you again to Nassim Taleb on this. First, I urge you to understand how the world has a more random structure than you believe, and how black swans impact strategies and projects. Second, I urge you to stop treating projects as if they exist in a deterministic Newtonian world of cause, effect, probability, and control. It does not work anymore. And third, in contrast, I urge you to study and learn complex adaptive systems with consequence-based, multidimensional, multi-scale, multicultural approaches. I see many things going in the right direction today, but frankly, a lot of this remains to be done, and I hope that every one of us and big communities like the PMO Global Alliance will work on this and heavily contribute to progress in this domain. Thank you. If you want to learn more, I'd published in book, a book in 1977. It's the sixth edition. It explained already many of the concepts I've touched based with you today. You can read my blog at www.philippehusser.com. Send me mails to discuss on my professional mail, highimpactpmo@gmail.com. Of course, connect on my profile on LinkedIn or tweet on @philippe_153. Thank you. Good luck. Bye.